Flying Cities begins here in London. Ovations for Eisenhower. Victory in Europe is followed by a modern version of the triumph accorded to conquering Roman generals of old. A sword of honor to be presented. One was ordered to be specially made, but it's not ready in time. And at the Guildhall, the Lord Mayor presents, as a token, the sword of the Duke of Wellington, conqueror of Napoleon. Prime Minister Churchill leads the British ovation, and at the Mansion House, General Ike bids a heartfelt farewell to Britain.
To every Londoner that has ever taken one of my soldiers into his home, I say you'll always have my profound gratitude. To everyone who has smilingly directed one of my men to the Albert Hall or the Marble Arch, I owe thanks also. To everyone who is, by his demeanor, his manner, or any word or act of helplessness, has done anything for an American soldier, I want to tell you one other thing. You have done something in cementing bonds that must always remain between your country and mine, and into which scope must be brought Russia, France, China, all the other great countries that have helped to whip this Nazi, and we hope will quickly whip Japan.
Britain's applause is phrased in stately Churchill words.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have just seen and listened to the words of a great commander. A man who has proved not only his capacity to organize and regulate the movements of armies, but to stir men's hearts, and who has shown a capacity for making great nations march together more truly united than they ever have before.
The after-the-war farewell of the two leaders who worked together so closely in achieving the victory in Europe. At the Arc de Triomphe, there's a stately military ceremony. France, liberated by Allied armies, pays homage to the supreme Allied commander. He comes to Paris to be decorated by General de Gaulle with the Medal of Liberation and the traditional kiss on both cheeks. A wreath on the tomb of the unknown soldier where the eternal light burns. Then for a tour through the boulevards of Paris. And the French capital pays fervent homage to Eisenhower as the chief of the forces of liberation. In the European war, he was more than a strategist who directed successful battles. He knew how to guide nations in concerted effort and to rally people to the cause of freedom, and as such, he is hailed. For long centuries, winning commanders have been acclaimed at the end of successful wars. But no conqueror in history has ever been cheered by a fraction of as many human beings as that unpretentious American. Paris goes wild over General Ike. The homecoming, and for the proudest woman in the land, a kiss. The victory commander and his wife. The national capital has the honor of being the first city to give America's greetings to General of the Army Dwight D. Eisenhower. Washington shows other cities how it's done. Add this to the record of historic homecoming ovations given to victory commanders of the past. General Pershing, Admiral Dewey, America's voice as Eisenhower drives to the Capitol. The general surrounded by camera cars, eagerness to provide a full and vivid film record of American welcome to the commander in the Western Front defeat of the nation's dangerous and savage enemy, the Nazi. Wounded veterans of the war, it is typical of Eisenhower that the triumph of the victor is halted for a greeting to the wounded, a greeting from General Ike. Climax is an appearance before a joint session of Congress. And in an address to the national legislature, Eisenhower tells what the victory means to him and to the armies he commanded.
My imagination could not picture a more dramatic moment than this in the life of any American. I stand before the elected federal lawmakers of our great republic, the very core of our political life and the symbol of those things we call the American heritage. To preserve that heritage, 3 million American citizens at your behest have faced resolutely every terror the ruthless Nazi could devise. The soldier knows how grim and black was the outlook for the Allies in 1941 and 1942. He is fully aware of the magnificent way the United Nations responded to the threat. To his mind, the problems of peace can be no more difficult than the one you had to solve more than 3 years ago, and which in one battle area has been brought to a glorious conclusion. He knows that in war, the threat of separate annihilation tends to hold allies together. He hopes we can find in peace a nobler incentive to produce the same unity.
President Truman presents an oak leaf cluster to the Distinguished Service Medal. The President has announced that General Eisenhower will continue as American representative in control of defeated Germany to secure the fruits of the victory that he did so much to win.